Live from the palatial studios at Emerson College in beautiful downtown Boston, this is the Jeff Santos Show on the Revolution Radio Network. Rebuilding America, together, investing, activism, and supporting the middle class. Now, here's Jeff.
Thank you, Ron, and good afternoon, Americans, and welcome to the Jeff Santos Show. We are live in Studio A on the campus of Emerson College. It is great to be with you on this 30th of November, 2016. Got a great program for you. Mark Taylor-Canfield will be with us for a good part of the hour of the show today. We'll be taking your phone calls, of course, at 772-925-8206. You can email me, Jeff@revolutionboston.com. Check us out on Facebook and Twitter at Jeff Santos Show. We got lots to talk about today. We're going to have some sound coming up from Mr. Tim Ryan, who got 63 votes today in a losing effort to dethrone Nancy Pelosi from her perch as head of the Democratic Party in the House, anyways. That's just particularly in the House. And I tell you, folks, you get me started. Been talking about this for a long time, that Democratic Party leadership needs change. Didn't get it with Schumer in the Senate. I mean, he at least was number three, and they moved him up to number one. In this case, they stay with the same person who's lost four consecutive elections. 134 votes for Pelosi, and of course, 63 for Mr. Ryan from Ohio. And we're going to play some sound bites from a conference call that I was a part of. And I got to ask a question toward the end, but we didn't get it to record. But I really feel the Democratic Party missed an opportunity here. And this, to me, as we listen to the Rolling Stones, Start Me Up, our song of the day, it's really starting again. We wanted to play the song anyways. And I'm hoping that people can get motivated even after another loss. But this is not to be considered a loss in this regard, because it's Washington, D.C. It's the same people who thought that Hillary Clinton was going to win in a landslide. It's an electoral landslide. It's the same people who said that, you know, we can pass the TPP, we can play around with it. The same people who said we can take money from Wall Street and still get the votes of working class Americans. So this crowd, they're still the same people. You're going to have the same people in leadership, all 70-somethings. So, in my view, we are at a point right now where we need to look outside of the Beltway, outside of the funders in New York City, a.k.a. Wall Street, and less of a dependence, although I wouldn't rule them out completely because there's some good people in Hollywood. But that access cannot be the heart and soul of the Democratic Party. It just cannot be if we're going to be a majority party in this country. Everybody wants to talk about, and I understand, that Hillary Clinton won the popular vote by 2 million more votes. Well, it doesn't take a genius to figure out that the most populist state in the country, with the second and, I believe, fourth largest media markets in Los Angeles and San Francisco, that's how you do it. Now, if the Republicans had focused as much on trying to win Texas by a bigger amount, the second largest state in the country, the popular vote might have been closer. But this idea that we solve the popular vote issue and we got to remove the Electoral College, there's no doubt. But that's not going to solve the problem that we're a minority country. And the Republicans aren't going to necessarily, you know, help you out and get rid of the Electoral College. So, again, we need to start again. We need to start in the Midwest, winning back governor seats, so we can control the next go-around when it comes to the pencil, as Jerry Austin would say. And that is writing the districts. That is what is at stake, folks. That is what is at stake, and that is how we're going to have to pull this together. Now, I can tell you this. If indeed the Democratic Party over the next 4 years are going to be a majority party, winning back state houses, particularly in the Midwest, then they're going to have to, you know, basically get out of the Washington, D.C. world, stop watching MSNBC and CNN, the same bloody pundits that come in all the time that are making $200 and $500 and $1 million a year that, you know, basically fill whatever sort of quota slash, age demographic, whatever you want to have, that they put on. You're going to have to rebuild it. And I'm hoping that this show can be part of it, because really, if you're going to just do the same thing, run the same kind of candidates, have the same kind of leadership, have the same kind of talking points, well, in my opinion, you're dead on arrival. And as Tim Ryan said over the last week or so, we're not even a minority party. And really, he's telling the truth. All right, I want to hear from you at 772-925-8206. As we bring in our new theme song for our great guest from Seattle, Washington. He is independent journalist. You catch him here every Tuesday on the Jeff Santos Show. He is a great friend of the show. He's a great guitarist, a great singer, and a great journalist. He is Mr. Mark Taylor-Canfield. Happy Tuesday to you, Mr. Mark. How are you, sir?
Good, Jeff. Always a pleasure to do your show, and very important independent voice in the media. So I encourage folks to go to the GoFundMe, keep Jeff's website, and donate and keep this show on the air. It's very, very important.
Well, I thank you for that, and that is indeed what we're all about over these next couple of weeks, and trying to raise an additional $7,000 or $8,000 goal. We're $1,600 into the $8,000 goal, so we've got a lot of work to do. But, Mark, it's people like you that I hear that the American people want to hear from, and I certainly want to, and I know a lot of our listeners do as well. And we need to keep not only my voice, but your voice and many of our contributors like Robert Craig and John Nichols and Jim Dean and many others who frequent the air here, Herb Boyd, Jerry Austin, Earl Bender, et cetera, et cetera. So we need to make that happen, and hopefully people will realize this. Unfortunately, today in Washington, D.C., a place that really is a swamp, Donald Trump was at least right in that regard, is that there are just too many people. And there are some good people, of course, in Washington, as there are people everywhere. But the fact is that so many of them are caught up in the bubble and succeeding of who's on first and who's on second. And they really don't care about improving folks that they don't come across. They don't even come across. If you live in D.C., as I did for 9 years, you basically live and work in the northwestern sector, the four sectors, northwest, southwest, southeast, and northeast. And unless you live on Capitol Hill, and there's a few people, including the members of Congress, that live there, they don't go beyond a certain area. Maybe it's Lincoln Park to Capitol Hill, which is a small couple of miles. And then you have, of course, the northwest area of DuPont Circle and Georgetown and, you know, all the way up to the Chevy Chase border. And that's where most people live, or they live in Arlington, Virginia, or across the river in Bethesda, or across the border in Bethesda, Maryland. And that's what they do. And this is why they don't talk to people in southeast D.C. in some of the poorest neighborhoods. They don't talk to people in the toughest neighborhoods in Toledo, Ohio, or in Detroit, Michigan. And that's why, you know, they're losing these places. Obviously, they would win Washington, D.C., but the fact is that they're really not getting it. And I ask you, Mark, because you see how people were so angered by the Clinton folks, by the Democratic Party, by Cantwell and Murray, and even McDermott on his way out. They wouldn't even talk to Sanders people. They wouldn't even accept a meeting. So people who are not even part of the Sanders movement in places like Ohio and all these other states that were lost by the Clinton campaign, then they're not going to get a voice. And the only person that's talking to him is the orangutan man with orange hair. At least he's talking to him. So, you know, somebody gives you a dime and promises you a dollar, and you don't have a dime or a dollar, you're probably going to go along with that guy, even if it's a potential lie, because, you know, you're out of luck. Your thoughts, my friend.
Well, Jeff, today is November 30th, and in Seattle, that's a very historic date, because in 1999, hundreds of thousands of people hit the streets for a week to oppose the World Trade Organization, and that included the Teamsters, the SEIU, longshoremen, environmental groups, human rights groups, trade organizations. These were all people who hadn't necessarily spoken together before or organized before. So there's the famous story of the environmentalists, you know, marching with the steelworkers.
Right.
And that was a model very successful against one of the most powerful organizations in the world. So what happened to that coalition? There were meetings in Seattle, and there was actually a group called the N30 Coalition trying to bring all of these groups together into a new, more progressive, more visionary and future-oriented organization or coalition, actually, of separate groups. And it never really happened. The corporate Democrats ended up taking over a lot of the electoral system. And so here in Seattle, you know, today a lot of us are thinking about what happened during that time. And that was my first experience, Jeff. Well, I was just visiting Seattle. It was my first experience of tear gas, rubber bullets, militarized police. And I just wanted to throw that in because today is the anniversary of the demonstrations against the World Trade Organization in Seattle. Now, as far as the specific situation with the Democrats today, I have two questions to ask. I guess as a journalist, I'm allowed to ask questions, right?
Yeah, I think
Well, at least for now.
I hope so. Yeah, exactly.
So I have two straightforward comments about what you just said. Actually, they're questions. Number one, are the Democrats still too entrenched in their powerful positions in U.S. politics and in Washington, D.C.? Are they a dinosaur, or are they going to be a fast, new, active, progressive, proactive party that really embraces new voices, new energy, new candidates, hopefully some working-class populist candidates? How about including some of the young, disillusioned, disenfranchised voters that helped fuel the very successful Bernie Sanders campaign that won, 23 states, right? Well, number two, did the Democrats learn any lessons about the need for populist candidates after this last national election? And I'm just throwing that out there because the decision to keep Nancy Pelosi in that position and not allow Tim Ryan to sort of bring this new energy into the party, I think, is another big mistake for the Democrats. Have they learned their lesson? I'm not so sure yet.
Jeff. I don't think so. If you know, 60 members of Congress, and I wouldn't be surprised because we don't know who they were, but these are probably people that have come in over the last, 10 years or so and are relatively new to all this, not the folks from the 70s and 80s and 90s that have been there for a long time and have seen Pelosi as their colleague since he's been there for, 30 years. So, in my view, no, a majority of them have not. But I guess it's sort of to be expected. And what I think, and I asked this to Tim Ryan, again, we don't have the recording, unfortunately, but I said, well, is it now time to focus on winning back governorships and state houses? And he said, yes, that's exactly what we got to do. He says, I went back in 2010 and started talking about the idea because the gerrymandering process was about to begin if the Republicans were to control all these governorships, that we have to start talking about things and as far as what can be done to help people in the Midwest. And the $900 billion infrastructure package, which was basically to get, Arlen Specter and a couple of other people to vote along with them, wasn't enough. They needed a couple of trillion, according to the civil engineers. Then, of course, they did this giveaway to the insurance companies in terms of health care. And again, there were some good things with the pre-existing condition and the kids under 27. But the fact is that it still wasn't enough, and now we see the health insurance companies basically, doing what they do. They collaborate to say, all right, well, you guys are gonna be one business, one person, one company for each state, and people are gonna have to pay because there's not gonna be any competition. Now, of course, Republicans, they're gonna bring in, take the lines down and all this stuff. We'll see what happens. But I wouldn't be expecting much from Trump and company. I just think that they're just really clueless, which to me is so important to have like a coordinated leadership. And I think it's interesting because outside of Washington, you have in the whole Cascadia idea, and of course, part of it is another country with British Columbia and Vancouver. But I would like to see, maybe you incorporate California, which is the big kahuna, the biggest state in the country. And the three Democratic governors, Oregon, Washington, and California, should come together, try to put together some resources, put together some information, and try to get that information out via alternative media, whatever the case may be. I'll volunteer. I know you will. To get a different perspective than what we're getting from Washington and the New York media. That, to me, is one of the only ways to do this. And I would say the same thing from New England governors, and the majority of them which are Democratic, and the ones that aren't, that we have to make sure they're changing in 2018, and coordinate that. And hopefully the Democrats get an understanding that they have to win back the Democratic governors in places like Ohio and Michigan and Wisconsin where they lost. That, to me, is the only way to do it, because I don't think we can rely on Washington and New York to change anything. I haven't seen any, in my lifetime, I haven't seen any sort of reason to think that by depending upon media and Washington, that it's going to change anything. I don't know about you.
Well, I hope I wasn't misinterpreted on several national media programs when I said that the Democrats need to go back to the old school way of doing politics. I didn't mean the Clinton administration. I meant the FDR coalitions.
Yes.
That gave us Social Security and gave us some measure of economic sustainability in this country at a time when people were starving. And folks, I know, some of my own relatives moved west from originally, of course, the East Coast and then the Midwest when a lot of the coal mines were shut down and then the farms, were taken by the banks and there was the Dust Bowl going on. People moved to the West Coast to find economic opportunity. A lot of people went to California. But at some point, some of those people actually moved north to the Northwest, or they just kept moving towards the Northwest. Partly because of the environment here, because let me tell you, folks from Minnesota really appreciate, you know, 58 degrees in the winter in Seattle. It might be rainy and sort of a very high humidity cold, but it's not, you know, 8 foot snow drifts outside the barn that you have to dig through to get to your horses. This is a much more temperate climate. So that's how the Northwest and the West Coast were settled. Of course, there were Spanish settlements here. And the British claimed part of the Northwest. There was the famous pig war here between the British and the American colonists, or actually it wasn't a colony, it was a territory at that time in the Oregon Territory that fought over the border between the U.S. and Canada.
Mm-hmm.
But in general, the West Coast and the Northwest have been leaders in a lot of issues of freedom and individuality. And you know, a lot of people still move to the West Coast to get away from the Eastern establishment. So I just wrote my latest guest column in the Capitol Hill Times is about this tradition we have in Seattle, and I call it Free Seattle. You know, it's a place where people can be free of reprisal for being a little bit different from the rest of the majority, where artists, musicians, you know, hippies at one time really had a lot to do with the culture here in Seattle. It was a place for people to go and create a sort of independent state of mind. Well, we're still like that. We just happen to be separated from other folks like us by a big sea of red states from Montana, stretching from Montana to Texas. And, you know, you have to get to the upper Midwest or the Northeast to find communities that are as progressively liberal as we are here in the Northwest. So
it's no doubt.
In my article, I'm pushing that idea that we need to stand strong in the Northwest for our values here. And I don't want to fight a civil war again, either figuratively or in any other way. But I think it's really important for people in the Northwest, the Northeast, and the upper Midwest to really join together in a progressive coalition across the country and bring back some of these populist candidates like Bernie Sanders so that people can feel involved in the electoral system again instead of being shut out by a guy who seems to want to, you know, set up another corporate dictatorship.
That's for sure. Talking with my good friend Mark Taylor Canfield here on the Jeff Santos Show. All right, Ron Kreider, I want to get a couple of Tim Ryan cuts here. Let's start out with the first cut. We'll start when we come back from the break then. That's the agenda we have. We'll come right back with Mark Taylor Canfield. It's the Jeff Santos Show. Back in a flash.
The Revolution Radio Network.
Investing. Activism. This is the Jeff Santos Show.
Four minutes past the hour. It is indeed the Jeff Santos Show. As I said at the beginning of the program, we were part of a conference call today with Tim Ryan and about, I don't know, 30 other reporters from across the country, including some from Ohio, as he went back and forth with a lot of us discussing. Unfortunately, some of the questions that that I had asked did not get answered, but we mentioned it earlier, and the fact is that he is open to and hoping that leadership across the country in the Democratic Party starts winning back the governor's races. And if you win the governor's races in the state houses, control the pencil, as our good friend Mr. Austin from Ohio would say, then that means you can control how the Democrats draw the line so you can win back some of these congressional seats. That may not happen until 2022. Maybe if there's a landslide in 2020, you can do it because the Democrats have to overperform in like the 55% or something you have to win by in order to make that happen. And right now, the Democrats haven't had a mission statement, a message to be able to do that. All right, let's play the first cut. This is called Talk to the Caucus, was the question from one of the reporters.
Did you guys have a chance to talk to the caucus before they took the secret ballot?
Yeah.
What did you say?
woman.
You know, I was pretty frank. You know, I said, you know, we're going to have a big boy, a big girl discussion here, and there was going to be a lot of truths that were going to be told from my perspective, and I was honest. I said, look, in family, sometimes you got to have really tough discussions that you sometimes put off, but you have to have them. And you know, I'm having one right now with you, and I said that, you know, you're the leaders of the Democratic Party in the country, in the most powerful country in the world, and our party is important to this democracy. And, you know, I let them know that I have been having issues and have been anxious about what the Democrats have been doing since 2010. And I, you know, mentioned that in 2010, and I got calls from people to tell me to, you know, stay in line. And I was on the Appropriations Committee and all the rest. So I bit my tongue, and as I told my colleagues, I bit my tongue and 2012 and 2014 and 2016, and you know, here we are as Democrats, where we just got slaughtered across the country, and I'm not going to bite my tongue anymore. And I spoke my piece.
Let's cut that there, Ron. Let me ask this to you. We're joined again by Mark Taylor Canfield, really through the top of the hour with Mark, and we'll get into some other discussions too, according to the Dakota pipeline issues. But Mark, I want to ask you to keep your comments if you can, because we got three more of these to go through, to about a minute a piece on these. What I want to get your thoughts on is that, you know, it sounds good that he talked to his colleagues. And that, you know, he's been mentioned, and he's biting his lip over the last 6 years. Now, 63 members out of 200, 198, that's good. You know, some people get it, but I still think that, you know, I don't think that Washington is going to be changed from inside. It's going to have to be a message from people on the ground. Your thoughts on that?
Yeah, I mean, if they can't change it from the top down, my theory was the best choice would be to start with the chairmanship of the Democratic National Committee and also the House Minority Leader, then work down from there at the same time that you're working from the bottom up. If that's not going to be possible, if the party is still so entrenched in their usual leadership, then I think, yeah, it's going to have to start with people like Congresswoman Pramila Jayapal, with people like Keith Ellison, Elizabeth Warren, Bernie Sanders. It's got to come from those people who actually can reach out to a populist electorate, and they're going to have to stir up things in their own communities and make it happen seat by seat through the state legislatures, through the governor's offices, through county commissioners, city councils, whatever it takes. That's what we've seen in Seattle, and that's sometimes the only way, Jeff, that you can actually get people organized in a true democratic fashion, is right at the local level, where you don't have these huge super PACs allied against you.
I agree. All right, let's hear Tim Ryan. This is cut two. This is the talking to the caucus. Anxiety at home. I apologize, Ron.
Yeah,
anxiety at home.
I feel, and I'm proud, most proud that we were able to give voice to a lot of people from back home, from Ohio, who really had a lot of anxiety about where our party is. They spoke out a couple of Tuesdays ago. Many people voted for Donald Trump. Many people stayed home because we didn't connect with them. And that's heartbreaking for me. And I felt like, maybe, you know, you always think maybe there was something more I could have done. Maybe I could have influenced the presidential election more. Maybe I could have got out there more, but it's really hard as one surrogate to try to define what the message is going to be. And yeah, I mean, I'm so proud to see, you know, on CNN or just national shows.
All right, let's cut it there, Ron. Here's the issue. The problem that I have with that is that at the end, he talked about the message. Now, obviously, you know, Hillary Clinton and the Democratic Party as a whole didn't have an economic message that resonated in Wisconsin or Michigan or in some of the other parts of the Midwest, where it was hard hit parts of the country. Never mind the South, which was sort of written off to begin with. But what I think is important here is that they have to get a message, yes, and a better communication, which obviously would mean that there's more independent and progressive talk programs and populist talk programs and, you know, in the middle of the country that are supported by those that are leaning Democrat, at the very least. But they're going to have to get policies. You know, the TPP as an example. You can't have, you know, the head of the party, you know, pushing this even after he lost. So, you know, there's a disconnect there from Obama on down. So I want to get your thoughts there. And I want to talk to Rudy after that in Chicago. Your thoughts, Mr. Mark.
Well, once again, my mind travels back to the demonstrations against the World Trade Organization, because that was all about trade policy. That was all about undemocratic institutions running the trade regime around the world. And hundreds of thousands of people came out, you know, and faced tear gas and no protest zones and illegal detentions and all sorts of things in order to take that issue head on. I just wonder what happened to that energy, and why is it that the Democrats are so loath to oppose the TPP at a time when Donald Trump literally, I hate to use this term, but trumped them on that issue. And Bernie Sanders had that issue fully in focus during his campaign, which is a large reason why he was so popular among independents and some conservatives.
That's right. Let's go to the phones, talk to our good friend Rudy in Chicago. Rudy, you're hearing this with Tim Ryan here. Do you think that he is a change agent, or is he just part of a disgruntled folks that, you know, just the fact that they lost? I think that he really would bring change to the party.
No, I think he is sincere, and I've seen him on, maybe it was on PBS, and he's... he really looks good. He really looks like a person that can handle the job as leader. And he's got the right ideas. It's just a matter of support. I think there are more populists in the Democratic Party than we know about, except
right.
that the leadership
they're not represented in the leadership in the Congress.
Yeah. And the leadership controls the money, so maybe some people don't want to stick their neck out too far. And we've got... Bernie and Warren are part of the leadership now in the Senate with Schumer, and I think they got the same thing going in the House now with Pelosi, and I think that the influence of progressives and populists are going to increase based on that, and I do think the leadership got the message finally from this election, and why they didn't do anything until now about it, like the voting machines, will never win if we don't control the voting machines. Bernie last night on Amy Goodman was talking about the paper ballots. We've got to get the vote down to a paper ballot. And he's absolutely right. And Jill Stein was on The View this morning, and she said when she said she was going to do the recount, donors' money came flying into her to do it. So the people out there that realize it. And about Washington, about the Democrats in Washington, you know, the way they reach out to the rest of the country is to a local Democratic Party and precinct captains. And they've been ignoring that for a long time.
Yep.
I'll let somebody tell me where Democratic headquarters is in Chicago.
Yeah.
I don't think you'll find it.
Yeah. So probably in some alley somewhere.
Yeah. So, I mean, when I was a kid... they had picnics for Democrats. They had this for Democrats. You see that precinct captain all the time. If you needed something, they would take care of it. Nothing anymore. You know,
yeah.
You can't do it with just TV and a bunch of baloney.
That's right.
And this guy Tom Price, that's going to be the Health and Human Services, who's going to take apart Medicare and Medicaid and Social Security, et cetera, et cetera. Everybody will be living on the street, including me. So, I don't know if this it was legislated into law, Medicare and Social Security. I don't know if anybody could file a lawsuit if they attempt to take this out of the out of the benefits that we get. I just don't know about that.
I think that there is going to be, and this is obviously a good thing that Democrats have in the past rally. Now, we'll see if any of them are bought off. Are scared off by 30-second ads running against them in 2018. This is a proof of the pudding, Mark. I want to get your thoughts here. You know, Rudy talked about going local. I mean, you know, there's a real desire here, and I think it's the only way to win, to make sure that people get active. And, you know, you talk Social Security, that activates a lot of seniors. You talk about cuts, you know, in student grants, that activates obviously a lot of young people who are in college. You know, you start, you know, there's a lot of warning signs here. The civil liberties, the civil rights issue, you get a lot of African-American Latinos involved here. So there's enough here to get a Democratic constituency, you know, up in arms. The question is, can they do it in the right way? And I think that it should be directed to winning governorships and winning back state houses, and not focusing on the hard stuff to change, which is the House and Senate. One is gerrymandered, and the other one, the Democrats have to hold on to about 20 seats. I find those very, very hard to do, which is why I think local is the answer. Mark?
Well, I think Rudy has the best comment of the day, which I'm going to tweet Rudy on my Twitter account site. But you can't do it with TV and baloney, okay?
There you
That's
go.
Correct.
That is very correct. Or salami,
but,
either.
Tom Price was a doctor, an orthopedic surgeon. Somebody ought to take a look and see if he had any malpractice claims against him. Because he's got a lot of malpractice as a politician.
That's for sure. 772-925-8206. Stay with me, Rudy, there. I want to play another cut. This is, again, going back to the idea of who is making policy and who's directing the Democratic Party strategy. This is cut number three.
Hey, this is Scott in Columbus. Can you hear me, Congressman?
Yes, sir.
Wanted to know, if you look at the congressional leadership of the party right now, if it's coming from California, from Nancy Pelosi's home state, and New York from Chuck Schumer's home state, how is the party reaching out to middle America?
Oh, well, that's going to be the issue. You know, that's really going to be the issue. And I brought it up and talked about it for the last 2 weeks. I think that is an issue, that we are a coastal party. And so the caucus decided to go ahead with Leader Pelosi again. And so, you know, we've got to figure out how to message and who maybe the messengers are to be able to come into regions like ours and pitch the kind of message that Democrats believe in. So I don't know moving forward. I don't think we know today. We're just a few hours away from the decision being made. And, you know, I, as I said, I never dreamed of running for House leadership. I did it because I felt like I could help. You know, I just felt like who I was and where I come from and, you know, the experiences that shaped me growing up allowed me to really connect to voters that we lost in droves on Tuesday.
Hmm. All right. Let me ask Rudy if you're still there, Rudy, and then I get Mark's thoughts on this. When you hear of the San Francisco, New York, no talk of the Midwest, and as Ryan is saying, doesn't that aggravate you as a citizen of the Midwest? You lived your whole life in Illinois, in Chicago, of course, which went for Hillary Clinton. But the fact is that, you know, you look at the leadership, Pelosi, number one from California, Schumer, of course, number one from New York in the Senate. In the House, you got Steny Hoyer from Maryland, just outside the Beltway. And, of course, Mr. Clyburn, who, you know, represents the African-American community, but from a state that's not even competitive for the Senate or the House or the presidential race in South Carolina. So it's kind of a useless threesome.
Yeah. I think there's a lot of talented people in politics in Illinois that could be useful to the party, especially if someone remembers the kind of party we had years ago. And it Adlai Stevenson and even Republican senator, I can't forget his name.
Right, that's all right. You know? But do you feel angered by the fact that there's nobody from Illinois or nobody from the Midwest as a whole in the top leadership there? I mean, maybe Ellison. I know Durbin is number three now, I guess, in the Senate leadership. But
yes, yeah, that's a good point. Durbin is very qualified and talented. But as I said about him before, he gets pushed out of the way by the corporate Democrats in the Senate. They jump all over him. But he's got good ideas, and he's a mild-mannered person, and I guess he doesn't really want to have an argument in the Senate with them. So that's the problem with bad leadership. Yeah. Leadership should expect everyone to contribute ideas within their party. There, you know.
Well, you hear what they said to Ryan: sit down and shut up. That's what they told him in 10, 12, 14, and eventually he said, all right, that's it. I'm sick of this. We lose four in a row. Somebody's got to say something. So we'll see. Thank you, Rudy, for the call. Mark, you know, I think that you got a situation here where, and we have one more cut to go, and then I want to get into the issue of what is happening in the pipeline, which connects, I think, to this next cut. This is about the millennials. This is the last cut, Mr. Ron.
Well, we can have a much longer conversation about this, because I think there needs to be a real comprehensive approach, one dealing with millennials and then one dealing with kind of working class. So a lot of it's what we're doing back home, you know, continuing to promote the expansion of additive manufacturing. I think that's going to be a real opportunity. Clearly, the infrastructure piece of a real robust, comprehensive, paid-for infrastructure investment in the country to the tune of $1 trillion, like the Trump administration is talking about, but it's got to be paid for, and it can't be a gimmick where it's these tax credits and all this nonsense. Like, let's spend money and build things where we can put working-class people back to work. I think what we're doing with natural gas, I think, is a great opportunity.
Let's cut it there. Mark, you know, he mentions natural gas, which is problematic. It obviously leads to fracking, and Ohio's got a lot of money out of that, as has Pennsylvania. But the environment, and that connects me to what's happened with the Dakota Pipeline. This is an issue, as he talked about, talking to millennials. This is a big issue. As you have found out, you're kind of on the edge of the millennial generation yourself. Talk to me about, you know, how you can communicate when a lot of the leadership of the Democratic Party, including Obama, has sort of been silent on the whole issue of the Dakota Pipeline. Your thoughts?
Well, first of all, I wanted to respond to the sit down and shut up strategy of the Democratic Party, which I just have to say, it's no secret that for a lot of progressives, including the progressive caucus of the Democratic Party in Washington State, that being told to sit down and shut up has been, how would the French say it, de rigueur for many years.
Yep.
It was very apparent during the Occupy Wall Street movement when some folks, including myself, tried to bring some of those ideas about trade and economic inequality into the platform of the Democratic Party, that a lot of people were told to sit down and shut up. A lot of progressive candidates for the nomination have been told down to sit down and shut up over the years. So a lot of people have experienced that. As far as what's going on in at Standing Rock, I think the Democrats could learn a lot about how to actually organize people on the ground, because thousands of people are headed to Standing Rock right now, including 2,000 veterans, partly because the U.S. Army Corps of Engineers has written a letter to the tribal leaders saying that they're going to do an eviction coming up in December, which will force people off of the Army Corps of Engineers owned land. So although it should be made very clear to people that due to the posse comitatus precedent in U.S. legal decisions and jurisdictions, it's not possible for the U.S. Army itself and, you know, let's be clear, the U.S. Army Corps of Engineers is not a combat unit. They cannot move the people off the land. It'll have to be the county sheriff's department, the state police will have to do that. But it's coming down to a major confrontation, so a lot of people have been headed there. There are a lot of reports of human rights abuses there at that part of North Dakota. The Sioux Nation and also many other tribes have joined together along with a diverse coalition of folks from around the country and around the world who are showing up there to help support this effort. And I want people to know that the tribal leaders have contacted the Department of Justice and asked for federal intervention because of the abuse of people's rights there that are demonstrating. They've used water cans on people in sub-freezing weather, which is very dangerous. There have been injuries and people being strip-searched and all sorts of terrible things. So the Department of Justice has been appealed to. And also there have been complaints to the United Nations Human Rights Commission about what's been going on there. So this has become an international issue now. The U.S. Army Corps of Engineers letter sort of frightened some people because it does say that people who remain on that land after the eviction do so, quote, at their own risk. So presumably that is because they could be arrested for trespassing at that point. But, you know, as I said, I think that the Democrats could really learn a lot about what's going on in terms of how to organize people on an issue-oriented basis about a very important issue, both for the tribes and also for the future energy policy of this country. Also, as we know, Amy Goodman was arrested there, along with another journalist, by the way, and she was charged with rioting. So that's another issue, of course, that I've been working on is freedom of the press issues. So here in Seattle, I'm calling for a citywide initiative to protect the rights of journalists because there have been too many circumstances of journalists being threatened with arrest by police while trying to do their job covering stories or being subjected 20
seconds,
to
Mark.
Crowd control devices during demonstrations. So I just wanted to put that out there. But yeah, the Democrats could learn a lot from what's happening at Standing Rock, Jeff, for sure.
Well, they certainly could. It's about water. It's about the environment. It's about life. That's nothing more important than that. Mark Taylor Canfield, thank you so much. Check him out on Twitter, Mark Taylor Canfield. It is end of the show, folks. We'll be back tomorrow. I want to thank Ron Cryer, producing the broadcast, with help from Sarah Billingsley on the web, our great team of Jack Casey and Dee Simpson here at Emerson College, and, of course, Gio and Freddie Santori on television. Keep on fighting, folks. My name is Jeff Santos, and I gotta go.
The Revolution Radio Network.
From the palatial studios at Emerson College in beautiful downtown Boston, this is the Jeff Santos Show on the Revolution Radio Network. Rebuilding America. Together. Invested. Activism. Now, here's Jeff.
Thank you, Ron, and good afternoon, Americans, and welcome to the Jeff Santos Show. We are live in Studio A on the campus of Emerson College. Great to be with you today. Mark Taylor Canfield of Seattle, where our song of the day originated, will be with us at 4:30. We'll talk a lot, including Julian Assange and what's coming out of WikiLeaks these days. It is Nirvana. It is Come As You Are. It was the theme of the early 90s in grunge. And it was real. It wasn't a put-on. It wasn't Milli Vanilli. It was real rock and roll, and it changed a lot of minds. And we need to continue that spirit